Okay. Yeah. So, hello everybody and welcome to my presentation. At the beginning, just some words to myself. My name is Paul Siedler and I work for the independent game studio Master Brain Bytes in Germany as a 3D environment artist. And beside that, I work as a teacher in a film school. There I have around 80 students and I teach them the magic of Blender, After Effects and Photoshop. When people ask me what my profession is and I tell them I'm a game artist, the reactions usually, oh, you're a game artist? What kinds of game you are making? Do you make games with dragons, guns and big explosions? And my answer usually is, yeah, kind of. We are making a farming simulator game. with. With tractors, cows, and corn, yeah? And maybe a space DLC someday, but it's a thing for the future. So, yeah, this is Cattle and Crops, a farming simulator with the goal to achieve a realistic farming experience in terms of fruit behavior, ground, and machines. In this presentation, I will give you a short overview about some workflows and how we use Blender for this. So I will start with the machines. Farming simulator, of course, needs a lot of machines like tractors, harvesters, and trailers. So our machines are very complex and detailed, so we need an efficient workflow for them. We have over 20 machines and more than 30 implements and trailers. Here you can see a small selection. And now I tell you a little bit about our workflow. At the beginning, we start with a photo scan from the real machine, or we ask for the CAD data from the producers of the machine. We also make a lot of photos to have good references and to see all the small details. Also, the real-world size is important as well, so we use scale bars for the scans, or we measure the size of the wheels and put the machines into relation to them, so we have the right size for the machines. At the beginning, or when we have the photo scan and all that stuff, we start to build the high poly. Most of the time, the high poly consists of more than 1,000 single pieces because a lot of objects are move-able and have to be separated for a clean normal bake and so on. So very often we bring Blender to the limits of performance with sometimes thousands of objects and more than 40 million polygons in just one blend file. Because of that, we work a lot with instances, so we have full control over that huge amount of objects. Forgot some line here. As I mentioned before, we have also a lot of movable parts, so it's very important for us to have the pivot points always at the right position and to keep the transformation data, so we are able to make quick changes and to keep the whole workflow non-destructive. Yeah, this is the keyword for this. This is also the reason why we do not use any array or mirror modifier, because the mirror modifier, for example, don't respect the pivot point for the duplicated object. So if we want to mirror, for example, we mirror all the objects we want to mirror to a helper object, we link duplicate all of them. So, and then we mirror all the objects with Control M to the other side. And as you can see, we now have the right pivot points also for the duplicates. And they are all instances from each other here. So it's still the same like the mirror modifier, but we have the right pivot points. So on the other hand here, you can see if we use a mirror modifier, the pivot point will be destroyed. So we also work a lot with layer management, for example, to separate different kind of objects like the high poly inside, the high poly outside, low poly inside, low poly outside, and so on. But 20 layers are not enough for us. So we expand this by using a lot of different materials for different kind of objects. So for example, every mirrored objects get their own material, like here, or every instance object. So we can select all of them with just two clicks. So yeah, we are really looking forward to Blender 2.8 with the new layer system. So we don't have to do this. Okay, so after we have our high poly finished, we use this simple material here to check the mesh for holes or invert faces. As you can see, it just gives front and back face a different color, pretty easy. In this example here, blue is good and red is bad. Here you can see some small red spots. And so we can, there is an invert face or there is a hole. And so we check the whole high poly before we start with the low poly. When all the thing, the stuff is done with the high poly, we can go on with the low poly. And the low poly, for the low poly, is of course very important that we have a good poly count. It's always a hot thing. And big machines like this tractor here is, have around 60,000 polygons for the inside and the outside together. We have here the inside of the tractor, a lot of polygons there. But after a certain distance, the inside will be hidden anyway, so we are left with around 40,000 triangles. And yeah, that's okay. It's also important to keep in mind, of course, that we want to bake a clean normal map. So if we have an object like here, like this here, it has be separate, of course, or we will get ugly bake results. Very often, it is also a problem in game engines to get the smoothing groups right. There are a lot of different ways to create and export smoothing groups in Blender, like sharp edges, or split the normals, or there are some other ways. And we are always work with auto smooth at 180 degrees, you cannot see here, and sharp edges. This is in our workflow. And you should not mix different techniques, like sometimes use the sharp edges, sometimes split the normals, sometimes use the shade flat command in the edit mode, for example. It will work perfectly inside of Blender. It's okay, it will look good. But if you export it to a game engine, you will get really bad errors with the smoothing groups. But there is a little workaround for you guys. If you did so, you can export the whole mesh as FBX and import it back to Blender, and then every kind of smoothing group you did will be stored as sharps. As sharp edges. And so now you can export it again as Collada or whatever, and you will have good smoothing groups in the engine. So let's drink. After the low poly inclusive, the UV map is finished, the mesh go over to IPack that to optimize the UV layout. For that, we join the mesh, the whole mesh, with the Texture Atlas add-on in Blender, and export that to IPack that, let the program do its thing, bring the mesh back to Blender, and copy the UVs to the Texture Atlas mesh in Blender, and finish the manual unwrap. So now we have all our instances back, but with the optimized UV layout from IPack that. And that's great. And from this mesh, we now have in Blender, we create basically three meshes. The first mesh is this nice thing here. That's the explode mesh for the normal map, for the normal bake. That means that every high poly with his associated low poly object will move with keyframe animation somewhere into the space to avoid wrong normal interaction. The second mesh is the ambient occlusion combine. That means that the whole mesh, except all the move-able parts, is joined together to get a clean ambient occlusion bake. The third mesh is the complete mesh, which will be imported to the game engine. For that, we just link duplicate all objects a last time, put them on a separate layer. Oh, I have an image for that. Put them on a separate layer, make them single users, and join all objects which belong together for animation. And now we have no longer thousands of objects. Instead, we have just all the small movable parts and the big static parts. For example, here, big static parts. Here, big static parts. And here, a lot of movable parts in this area. Yeah. For the engine ready object or mesh, we export a lot of separate files, like as you can see here, like one for the inside, one for the inside decals, outside decals, tires, and so on. Okay, so, but before we export anything, it's essential to check the scale. Yeah. The scale needs to be 1. If the scale is, for example, 1.3 in Blender, yeah, then the tangent space and the UV map will be scaled by 30% in the engine. And this is really bad. You should not do this. After the bake ready meshes, or after that, the bake ready meshes come over to Substance Painter. And there they get all their textures. And we create completely PBR materials in Substance, and all the PBR passes are saved in 3 textures. As you can see here, we have the albedo map with the RGB channel for the color information, of course, and the alpha channel for the transparency. We have the normal map with the RGB channel for the color info for the normal information. Sorry. And we have the roughness map with the red channel for the roughness, the green channel for the metalness, the blue channel for the ambient occlusion, and the alpha channel for the dirt mask. That looks like this here, really nice colored image. And after this, all the textures and the mesh come over to our game engine, and there the textures and the mesh will come together, and the machine also will get all the controllers and the lights, as you can see here. Yeah, chaos pure, yeah, chaos. Yeah, so we now have our machine ready here in our game engine. So now I show you some machines in action. I hope the video will play or not? That's not good. Sorry? One more time? Ah, okay. Okay. Oh, okay. Just one more click. Here you can see the first run of the fieldwork. It's about cultivating and loosening up the ground. Here you can see I lower my cultivator attachment, and now I drive over the fields. No. Just 1 second. And here you can see that our ground, not very good in this example. You can see the ground is dynamic. We have dynamic tire tracks, and also the ground will change depending on the attachment you use. And by the way, this is here not our our final map. This is our debugging and testing map, tech demo map we also released for testing and debugging. Here is the second step. It's called plowing. Yeah. So I change my attachment and I create the lines where the seat later will be. And here you can see the dynamic ground a little bit better. Yeah. Okay. After we plow the field, we can bring out the seat. In this example, it's maize seat. And there, I know I plow the field a little bit quick and dirty before. In a perfect world, there should be equal lines. Okay. It's just for the example. So here we can see in just 1 second how the seed will come to the field. Of course, in the game, you have to go to the city first, buy the seeds, or use the reserves from your farm. And but in this example, yeah, we have our seeds here. Okay. So here you can see all small movable parts. Ay, ay, ay. So after a while, the maize will grow, but only if you take good care of it. That means that you have bring fertilizer from time to time, or water if it's not raining. Also, the values of the ground are very important, but in this example, I skip all that and come directly to the harvesting. Here you can see one of our harvesters, and you also can see there's an AI helper following me with a tractor and the trailer to catch the harvest. If the trailer is full, he will automatically return to the farm and bring the harvest to the silo. You can also enter the tractor on yourself, and later it will also be possible to play this with a friend. Yay! One can drive the tractor and own the harvesters. Yeah, farming together is great. So, oh yeah, next one. Take a look at the inside of one tractor. Here we can activate the cap controls. So we can now use the mouse to adjust the mirrors, for example, here. Yeah. We can open the door. And we can close it. It's also possible, yeah. And we can start and stop the engine. And yeah, do a lot of other stuff. It's great, it's great. So, yeah, you can adjust the reel and, yeah. Okay, that's it. Next, I tell you a little bit more about our environment, especially about modular buildings. Here you can see some of the buildings we built for the game. No building is built unique. They are all built from a set of modular pieces. Here's a small example. That are the buildings here. And here you can see some modular parts. I have another example here with some industrial buildings and also the set here. And for this, we started with a plane, 3 by 3 meters. And every other element is oriented by the size. Our texture scale for environment objects is 1024 pixels on 3 meters. So to make sure that every element is compatible and also work well with the tiling texture, we can now create elements with 3 meters, 6 meters, 9 meters, and 1.5 meters for edge elements, like this here, and so on here, 12 meters, whatever. Let's switch to the right part. And this is also the same with the roofing. We have roofs with different angles, but all of them fit into the 3 meter rule. So theoretically, every building can get every roof. So on this base, we can now create more complex building parts, like windows and door elements. And as long they follow this rule, this 3 meter rule, and with the depth space, the space in the depth there, we are completely free, so we can create whatever we want, as you can see here, some bigger parts or whatever. And these are some or a lot of variations we are created very quick on the base of this 3 by 3 meter wall element. All this is just on this base. So, at the next step is we can put the buildings together by snapping the single elements to each other, yeah, and that we can do very quick. We can create now big buildings, small buildings, whatever we want. This is just an example here. You can also see we have some special pieces here and here, which work as fill elements for corners or between walls and roofs. So we can create much more details and variations. One important thing when putting all the buildings together is to keep the single modular parts always as instances from each other. So when we want to update one part, it will be changed on every building we created. Yeah, can you see a little example for this? This is the same modular part here. And we want to change something, and it will change on every building. So. Okay, now is the time to talk about our level of detail system. We have three levels, the LOD0, LOD1 after 250 meters, and LOD2 after 500 meters. And LOD0 is just what we created here, the detailed building with all the small things here like mailboxes, water pipes, door handles, and so on. For LOD1, we dismiss a lot of these small details. I can switch over here again, can see. And because we had kept the instances before, we can do this now very quick by just reducing the single modular parts, and it will be updated on every building. So we can do this very, very quick. Of course, it's important to save a different blend file before this, so you can keep the LOD0. Yeah. So. After joining each building to one mesh, we can now create the LOD2. For this, we created just a simple box shape for every building, as you can see here. And then we baked the whole village with over 60 different buildings on just one single texture atlas with just a resolution of 1024 by 1024. There's something missing here. Okay. Just a little bit of text. So this is the whole village with over 60 different buildings in just a 1K resolution. And this is completely fine for the wider distance. And as you can see, we still have some space left here for additional buildings. So yeah, we can do much more. Yay. Here you can see a screenshot from the engine from a part of the village with some of the different buildings. By the way, the village is inspired by villages in northern Germany. There we have a lot this red stone buildings. Okay. To fill this village, we also need a lot of different environment objects beside the buildings. So here you can see some of little environment objects we created for the game. The buildings, all of them have been textured in Blender, not in Substance this time. For the most of the objects, we create the high poly at first. Oh, still text missing here, why? Okay, this is the high poly, this is the low poly. Okay, here you can see much more details in this area, for example, and here's just a flat plane. So we create the high poly and the low poly. Then we textured the high poly mostly with the help of generated and box mapping. Yeah, created all the PBR passes. And because at this time the principal shader was not included in Blender, and we need it. our main programmer created a little shader node group that gives us an accurate PBR look that behaves exactly like Substance Painter and Unreal Engine 4. So we have a good material base. And then we baked all the textures, the PBR passes over to our low poly object, saved them into the three textures as I showed you before with the machines. And now we have here our ready mesh in our game engine. And with the help of vertex color, we are also able to change the color of one object, so we can create a lot of color variations of one object, as you can see here for these containers. Important to note at this point is that we use albedo maps and no diffuse maps. And there is text missing again. Diffuse map, albedo map. Okay. In the past, I noticed a lot of people in the internet who thought it's the same thing, albedo and diffuse map. And this is completely wrong. And I try to explain to you, diffuse map contains shading information, as you can see here, like ambient occlusion or glossy or stuff like that. It's just like you take a photo from whatever in the real world. And that's very bad for texturing because these informations are not dynamic. And an albedo map, on the other hand, is completely free from this information, as you can see here. It contains just the flat color information. So the advantage of this is that we can now use a different ambient occlusion map, which will interact with the light in the game engine. So for example, if the light shines directly on a corner where the ambient occlusion should be, the ambient occlusion will fade away. And that will not happen if you just bake your ambient occlusion into your color map. And so in conclusion, albedo maps behave much more realistic. That's the thing. So now I proceed over to how our world was built. Here you can see a screenshot from our map. At first, I need to say that we evolve our own engine on the base of the C4 engine. The foundation of the engine is really, really old, but it has the advantage that we have the full access to the source code. So our programmers implemented a lot of cool features in the past, like tessellation, like dynamic ground, and voxel-based filling for trailers and silos and stuff like that. And the disadvantage is that we're still missing a lot of features, like good world-building tools. So to have more control over this, we decided after a lot of testing to build the map completely in Blender and also place the buildings there. But with this technique, we also had a lot of problems in Blender. So for example, we created a new blend file where the whole map will come together. And there we imported all the buildings. But a big problem in Blender, when you import a lot of objects with shared materials, they will get numbered. So you now have every material exactly as often as you have buildings in this example. And the solution for this will be to select every building and replace the material by hand, go to the next one. And the problem was that some buildings shared the same material and some not, so we cannot just automatically link all the materials together. And to get rid of this, our main programmer created a little Python script called remove duplicated materials. Catchy name for this, yeah. And what this does is it just search for materials that have 0.001, 0.002, and so on after his name, as you can see here, and replace it with the same material without the suffix. So as you can see here, yeah. So every duplicated material is now gone. So, this is. The terrain of our first main map is 2 kilometers by 2 kilometers big and was completely created in Blender. And we create the map, and then we placed all the streets, the village, and the rivers, and so on. After planning it very long, yeah, for a very long time, we're just doing planning stuff and think about it. And after that, we create a much bigger world around our playable ground here, where the player can't go. That's called the debug forest, and it's just for the wide view, yeah, to let the player think the world is much, much bigger. We don't like the idea of big mountains surrounding a small valley to set the borders of the world, so we tried to make the borders very natural by sometimes using a construction site on the street or a dense forest, not on the street but on the fields, and we like this much, much more. Our world also has a level of detail, so we cut the whole map into several pieces at natural borders like streets or rivers or so on. So we can now switch to the low poly terrain pieces after a certain distance. What I forgot before, when we built or a second reason why we built the map completely in Blender is also a performance reason, because you can optimize. You can optimize everything individually. Yeah. So we tried to import the map as a height map in the engine, but with this we have a reaction time of, I guess, 3.5 milliseconds per frame, and with the static world from Blender we have just 0.5 milliseconds per frame. And the reason for this is that the height map is equally subdivided, and for the static mesh, we can make much less polygons in flat areas, for example. So it's much more optimized. Okay, so after the world with all the streets were finished, we placed all the buildings and the fences in Blender, and exported to the game engine after that. All the LODs were parented directly to the main object, so we also have them into the right place. And then we exported to the game engine. In the game engine, we added all the small objects like lamps, garbage cans, cars, and so on, because for them we can use instances in the engine, and that makes much more sense. So here you can now see some screenshots again from our village. Here a wide shot and some more images from the village. The village and the whole map is not completely finished yet. We will hopefully finish it in the next weeks. So here are some nice little streets. Okay, and a screenshot at night, but it's very not good to see here. Can you lower the lights, maybe? Okay, it's a little bit better. Yeah, okay, it's the village at night. Yeah, thank you. Thank you. So here are some final landscape shots. Okay, that's it. I want to thank you and give credit to my colleagues at MasterBrainBytes and also my boss, and also the more than 40,000 supporters who made this company and our jobs possible with over 650,000 euros of crowdfunding right now. This is really awesome. And I thank you for your attention. If you want to learn more, you can go to cattleandcrops.com. We released a small tech demo so far. You can try it out. And we hopefully will start with the early access very soon. And if you don't like farming, feel free to dive into my private portfolio at ArtStation. And there you can also find dragons. So thank you.